Recorded Books presents Petals and Poison by Jess Dillon. Narrated by Sandy Rustin. Chapter 1. Something's missing. Frowning, I studied the array of flowers, greenery, and assorted decorations I'd arranged in the picture window. In the center, fresh bouquets of bright zinnias fairly burst with color and sheer. On one side, a stand of purple and pink phalaenopsis orchids called to mind luxury and elegance. On the other side, a tied bouquet of fat, luscious silk peonies sang of romance and riches. The pottery, glazed ceramics, handcrafted by local artisans, added an upscale touch, while the garden art kept things playful, especially the chubby gnome, ladybug fairy hut, and rainbow-hued metal spinner. As a backdrop, trailing ivy and potted ferns brought a lush, vibrant greenness to the scene. I leaned over to straighten two small wooden signs, declaring, "Welcome" and "Be happy." Then stood back with hand on chin. It all looked very nice. The overall effect was secret garden meets enchanted forest. But was it attractive enough? Meaning, would it attract the good vibes, abundant customers, and business growth I was going for? "Sierra Ravenswood, are you still working on that display?" Dina Lee, my right-hand woman and new best friend, breezed in from the back room, her skirt swishing and heels clicking on the tile floor. We'd run in different circles back in high school, but when we both returned to our hometown of Erroville, Tennessee, a decade later, Dina and I found we had more in common than we ever knew. I was still grateful she'd decided to stay and work for me at the flower shop. She had a good eye for beautiful designs. "It looks fine," she assured me. "It looked fine half an hour ago." "Yeah, maybe. But I'm trying something here." "You know," she went on, "it's not like we get much foot traffic on Oak Street anyway." That was true. Flower House was in the old section of town. We were one of a few converted Victorians in a quiet, mostly residential neighborhood. The only other businesses on the block were a small bakery, a dusty antique shop, an accountant's office, and a volunteer-run, rarely open, historical society. At the end of the street was a forgotten little park called Melody Gardens, all the more reason to take extraordinary steps to lure in new customers. "This is more than an everyday window display," I said. The one I'd just removed had been more traditional, with lots of red, white, and blue in honor of Independence Day. Now that the holiday was over, I wanted to go in another direction. "This is a vision board of sorts. Everything I included is meant to symbolize abundance and prosperity, like the vines, fast-growing because we need to grow fast." She gave me a bemused look. "That's why we're opening the cafe next weekend. People will come in to try our edible flower goodies, then make a purchase while they're here." Dina would be the chef in our new mini restaurant. "I know, but it can't hurt to infuse the place with an extra bit of luck." I looked at the display again and tilted my head. Was that what was missing? A lucky charm? "How about this?" said Dina, as if reading my mind. She took a potted bamboo plant off a nearby shelf and handed it to me. "Lucky bamboo." "That's a spirit." Nodding with approval, I took the plant from her and found a place for it in the display. If it works for the Chinese, why not for us? "Not just the Chinese," she said. "Koreans, too. My grandparents swear by it. Well, that and pigs. Pigs are even luckier than bamboo." "Pigs? Really?" I looked around as if I might find a pig figurine in the shop. There was none. "Yeah," Dina laughed. "According to my grandmother, anyway. Grandma Benna's almost as superstitious as your granny." "No way," I said with a smile. "Granny May's whole life revolves around her superstitions." "You'd be surprised. When I was in school, Grandma Benna always used to tell me not to wash my hair before a test. Otherwise, I'd wash all my knowledge right down the drain." "And did you listen to her?" Dina had been one of the prettiest, most popular girls in our class. I was quite sure she'd never come to school with unwashed hair. "Of course. Why take chances? Right, I smirked. Could you imagine if Granny May met Grandma Benna? I'd love to be a fly on the wall for that conversation. I loved my granny to pieces, but could never understand why she put so much stock in superstitions that had no basis in fact nor science. I, on the other hand, based my beliefs on personal experience. At least, I tried to. In my view, it was true that certain symbols and images could hold positive energy and bring about change, but that was because of the viewer's own state of mind. It was the simple law of attraction. Come to think of it, maybe Granny May and I weren't that different after all. I'd been seeing a lot more of my granny lately, ever since she'd planted a patch of flowers and herbs out back near the greenhouse. She came down from her home in the mountains about once a week, hitching a ride with her neighbor, Wanda Milford, who was a few years younger than Granny. Wanda liked to come into town to grocery shop and get her hair done. Granny liked to impart homespun wisdom and keep an eye on me. Dina picked up a feather duster and ran it over a table holding glass vases and metal urns of fresh flowers. Grandma Benna makes a trip from Seoul at least once a year, she said. I'll have to bring her by next time. For sure, I'd love to meet her. I headed for the front door. I'm gonna look at this display from outside now. I still think something's missing. I plucked a mint leaf from the planter on the stoop and rubbed it between my thumb and forefinger. Walking to the front of the house, I sniffed the minty sweetness. Good stuff, I thought. One of life's small pleasures. If Dina saw me doing this, she might call me Amelie, after the character in the French movie. I guessed I could be quirky and imaginative like that. Or maybe it was just because of my brunette hair and short bangs. I took a gander at the window display, immediately noting where I needed to shift things around for better effect. But my attention soon wandered up the face of the building, from the baby blue and white trim to the dusty rose scalloped siding beneath the gable roof. Sunlight glinted off the single circular window at the top. All at once, I felt a jumble of emotions wash over me. Foremost, a blend of pride and satisfaction, tempered with a healthy dose of worry and angst. The place was all mine, and it was all thanks to one impulsive decision by my old boss, Felix Maniford. He'd built this business from the ground up together with his late wife, Georgina. Flower House had become an institution, and not just in little old Airyville. The Manifords became known far and wide for Georgina's collection of exotic orchids and Felix's hothouse roses, not to mention the special flair Felix always brought to his bouquet arrangements. I was just a part-time helper, until Felix up and left one day. He'd set off on a folly of a treasure hunt somewhere out west. He was so intent on his new adventure, he'd left everything behind, and he'd given me his shop to do with as I pleased. Talk about your mixed blessings, I muttered to myself. It was the career opportunity I never knew I wanted. I'd planned to be a professional singer-songwriter, in spite of my false start in Nashville a while back. I was going to travel, get rich and famous, meet exciting people, and find fantasy-worthy romance. Instead, I was here, firmly ensconced in my Appalachian hometown, trying to make it as a small business owner. So far, it was mostly fun and exciting, when it wasn't tiring or terrifying. A sharp bark pulled me from my reverie. I turned to see my corgi, Gus, another gift from Felix, trotting up the sidewalk on stubby little legs. I had to grin at his eager mini-wolf face, big ears, and furry bread loaf of a body. Then I glanced up at the guy on the other end of the leash, and my grin widened by a smidge. Calvin, my second employee and only tenant. He tended the plants we grew on site and helped with maintenance and dog wrangling. It was sweet of him to take Gus out of Flower House and for a walk. Cal had been working overtime in the greenhouse, helping to get ready for the grand opening of our cafe next Saturday. For that matter, he'd been working overtime at Flower House ever since he showed up here 3 months ago and moved into the upstairs apartment. He'd been an immense help to me. More than that, he'd also turned out to be a fun person to have around. And then some. I watched as Gus led Calvin on a zigzaggy sniffing tour up the block. What was it about that guy that made my heart go flippity-flop? He was of average height and average build, on the thin side, actually. Nothing like the bodybuilder physique of my dad and brother, who, together with my mom, ran Dumbbell's gym downtown. He was kind of nerdy, really, prone to making goofy puns, and way more into plants than your average gardener, which made sense since he'd been an adjunct botany professor in Knoxville before moving to Erroville. Of course, he'd copped a nerdy persona on purpose when he'd first introduced himself to me. As he later confessed, he'd thought it would make him seem more trustworthy and help conceal his real reason for being here. To be honest, I still wasn't sure how well I knew the real Calvin Foxheart. He looked up at me then, as he and Gus finally stepped onto the lawn in front of Flower House, and flashed a carefree smile. I realized then that there were a few things I did know for sure. I knew he had a nice face, with a masculine jawline and sparkling blue eyes. I knew he was good with Gus, and I knew he was hardworking, generous, funny, and kind. Still, it was hard to get past the fact that he hadn't been completely honest with me from the start, and I'd been burned by dishonest men before. "Hey," he said casually, "what's on your mind? You look conflicted about something." I started. Was I that transparent? "I am conflicted. I'm trying to decide if I should add a money tree to the display." I hooked my thumb toward the window behind me. Dina suggested the lucky bamboo plant, and it got me thinking about other plants that symbolize prosperity. Bart is stopping by with a delivery sometime today. I could order the plant from him.
"Sure, why not?" said Calvin. "You said the display is meant to remind you of what you want, right? I say go for it, don't hold back."
His expression was slightly amused, tinged with genuine curiosity. "I know you view this as a case study," I said with a smile, "but this sort of thing has worked for me before, plenty of times."
"Really?"
He pursed his lips, as if pondering the possibilities.
"Sounds like you hold a magic lamp then, like with a genie who will grant all your wishes, but if it's that easy, then why not do it for everything you want?"
He paused and cocked his head.
"Or have you? Is everything in your life here now because you've attracted it?"
I shrugged, not bothered by the questions. "In a way, yes. I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, but in general, yes, this is true for everybody. Whatever we put our attention on, good or bad, conscious or not, is what we draw to us." He nodded slowly, fixing me with an interested gaze. A second went by, and I imagined I felt a charge pass between us. Was he training his attention on me because of what I'd just said? Was he trying to draw me to him? A small smile played at his lips, and I realized he was teasing me. "You don't believe it's true?" I asked.
"You know me, I'm a man of science. I like to see proof."
He nodded toward the window.
"We'll see if this little experiment of yours brings in an influx of money, like an unexpected amount of business growth. If it does, then we'll know. You'll have found the rainbow leading to a pot of gold."
I smiled again. "Well, I already know, but yeah, then you'll know too."
"Speaking of treasure," he said, "hear anything from Felix lately?"
And there it was. The reason Calvin had shown up in my life in the first place, and possibly the reason he stayed. His intense interest in Felix's treasure hunt. The Arwen treasure was purportedly hidden somewhere in the wilds out west by an eccentric, wealthy antique collector. A series of hidden riddles and clues had kept treasure seekers on the hunt for several years now. "As a matter of fact, yes," I said. "He called me the other day to catch up. Actually, he'd wanted me to look up something in one of the many books he'd left behind."
"How's he doing? Getting any closer?"
I shook my head. He didn't say, but I kind of doubt it. He mentioned he might come back to Erroville for the winter if he hasn't found it before then. I hoped he would come back. There was so much I wanted to ask Felix about the business.
I take it he hasn't been bothered by any of the other treasure hunters? Said Calvin. I asked, and he only laughed. He always laughs about that. Before Calvin could pursue the subject any further, Gus jumped up and barked as a car swerved to a stop by the curb in front of the shop. It was an old Subaru Outback, Granny's car, driven by her friend Wanda. Though Wanda usually drove, they alternated between Granny's car and Wanda's SUV. Both ladies piled out of the Outback, Granny dressed for gardening in rolled-up jeans, a cotton shirt, and a floppy straw hat, and Wanda dressed for Hawaii, apparently, in a floral print muumuu. As Granny lifted the hatchback and retrieved various bags and baskets, Wanda scurried up the sidewalk, frazzled and in a hurry. Hello, dear. Can I use your powder room? Yours is much nicer than the one at the salon. Of course, I said, as she was already halfway in the door. Calvin handed me Gus's leash and hurried over to Granny to help carry her bags. I joined them on the sidewalk and gave Granny a kiss on the cheek.
Don't mind her, said Granny. Wanda got into a little tussle at the meat market, bopped the butcher right on the head with a foot-long salami.
What? Surely I hadn't heard her right. Calvin laughed.
No kidding?
Granny reached into a bag for a small piece of lunch meat and gave it to Gus, who was sitting attentively right in front of her like a good boy. He knew what visits from Granny meant.
Well, he'd been ignoring her,
said Granny, presumably referring to the butcher. Wanda doesn't like to be ignored.
Can't really blame her. Folks are always ignoring us old ladies.
She really hit him on the head? I asked. Not hard, I assume.
Hard enough. I had to drag her out of there before she did it again. It's getting to be a habit with her.
Hitting people on the head with salami? Asked Calvin.
Not just salami. It all started with her no-good drunk of a husband many years ago, rest his soul. She bopped him on the head with a frying pan. Of course, he deserved it and didn't press charges. Ever since then, that's been her M.O.
Granny scratched Gus behind the ears as she squinted her eyes with something like worry.
Disrespect Wanda and watch out. You might get bopped on the head.
Calvin and I looked at each other, sharing equal parts shock and amusement.
Good to know, said Calvin.
He headed up to the front door and held it open.
I promise I'll never disrespect Wanda.
Inside, Granny looked around and commented on how nice the shop looked. Dina waved from behind the wooden counter in the center of the front room, where she was on the phone by the cash register. Calvin took Granny's bags to the large kitchen in the back that doubled as our workroom.
Why, what a pretty little space you've created, said Granny,
peering through the arched entryway leading from the shop's main room to the cafe area on the left. When Felix abandoned his idea for a cafe after Georgina died, this area had become a cluttery mishmash of a room. It was mainly used for storage and occasional special events, such as the bouquet arranging class I'd led in the spring. Unfortunately, that time around, it had also become a murder scene. I shuddered at the memory. We've been working hard the past few weeks. The place did look pretty, if I said so myself. Of course, there were flowers and plants galore, and we'd opted for a sort of rustic Parisian decor, with eclectic furniture and vintage botanical prints on the walls. In addition to four small round tables, we'd added a velvet couch along one wall, giving the space a cozy coffee shop vibe. We'd even found an old brass chandelier at the antique shop across the street. We got all our permits squared away and the menu all planned. Now we just hope folks will come by.
Well, I'm sure they will, said ever-supportive Granny.
She was a nice counterbalance to her daughter. My mom couldn't seem to help offering dire warnings about how so many new small businesses fail within the first year, especially restaurants, and how location plays a big part in that depressing statistic. She meant well. Dina hung up the phone and joined us in the cafe. We just received an order for a get-well bouquet. I can deliver it this afternoon. I'm supposed to meet my parents for dinner anyway. Dina's parents both worked at the county hospital, her mother as a healthcare manager and her father as a cardiologist.
That's great.
At this point, every order was cause for celebration.
Maybe you could stop by the gift shop and ask them again if they'd consider doing business with us. We could easily keep them stocked in simple bouquets each week.
I'll ask, Dina promised.
Granny turned to me. Business is going well? She asked.
Yes, ma'am, we're doing great. Can't complain.
She continued to give me the eagle eye. Granny may have been kind and supportive, but she was also shrewd. There was no fooling Granny. I mean, we do a steady business for the most part. We're getting orders every day.
And? She prodded.
And? Well, I do worry about cash flow now and then. You know, we had to spend a pretty penny restoring the place following the, incidents last spring. Besides the murder, there'd been a fair amount of destruction and vandalism in both our shop and the greenhouse. Granny nodded.
Your mama told me insurance covered most, but not all, of your losses.
That's right. And then, of course, we had to buy some things to get the cafe ready. But I'm not worried that much. I think the cafe will boost our income. Plus, there's this. I pointed to my window display. It's meant to ensure good luck. See, we have lucky bamboo and fast-growing ivy. And these flowers are known to represent wealth and good fortune.
Hmm, said Granny. Is that right? I didn't know those were lucky flowers.
Well, maybe it depends on who you ask, but they seem lucky to me.
Where's your four-leaf clovers? Where's your acorns and lucky pennies?
She looked doubtfully at the bamboo plant.
Maybe some healing herbs would make more sense in these parts.
Great idea, I said quickly. Granny had been teaching me about bad omens and lucky charms my whole life. I hoped I didn't offend her by getting it all wrong. I want to start incorporating herbs in some of our bouquet arrangements anyway. I think it fits with the edible flower theme. Calvin came out of the back room with Gus at his heels and joined us up front.
Is anybody getting hungry for lunch yet? I couldn't help noticing Granny brought...
He was interrupted by a shrill scream. We all jumped, and Gus barked as Wanda came running out of the hall bathroom, covering her head with her hands.
Land sakes! It came straight from my scalp!
We all stared at her. What did? I asked. Are you okay?
What happened? Said Granny.
A bird? I don't know what kind. Some sort of mad, crazy bird.
Wanda was dancing in circles, as if trying to shake off the heebie-jeebies. Granny rushed up to her and clasped both her arms, effectively halting her in place.
Take a breath, Wanda. Tell us what happened.
She took a deep, shuddering inhale and pointed to the bathroom door.
I opened the window in there. For fresh air, you know, I was just washing up, reapplying my lipstick and whatnot, when out of nowhere, a bird flies in the window.
Granny paled at this news and let go of Wanda's arms. Is it still in there? I asked. The poor thing must be scared.
I think it wanted my hair for its nest, said Wanda. It flew right at me.
Calvin grabbed a broom and headed for the bathroom.
Don't hurt it, I called after him.
I'm just going to shoo it out the window,
he said, closing the door behind him. Gus scratched at the closed door, evidently wanting to help.
Why don't you sit down? Suggested Dina to Wanda. I'll get you a glass of water.
Wanda nodded and took a seat in the cafe room. I set out glasses for both Wanda and Granny, while Dina took out a pitcher of lemon water from the fridge behind the small cafe counter.
Are you okay, Granny? I asked, leading her to the chair across from Wanda.
For some reason, Granny now appeared more shaken than Wanda. She removed her straw hat and wiped her forehead.
I'm fine.
She took a sip of water, then directed a disapproving gaze at Wanda.
Why'd you have to go and open a window with no screen? It only invites trouble.
Wanda frowned right back at Granny.
It's not my fault that a silly bird flew inside.
Well, you know what it means, don't you? Said Granny. At first, Dina and I followed their exchange in confusion. But with Granny's last words, it was dawning on me what had her so upset.
Oh, said Wanda shortly, you don't think.
She trailed off and covered her mouth with her hand.
I do think, said Granny soberly. But it's just an old wives' tale, protested Wanda.
What is? Asked Dina. What are you worried about? Granny shook her head, then looked from Wanda to Dina and me.
Sorry to say this, girls, but it's bad news. If a bird flies in the window, it means someone is going to die. Someone in this very house.
Chapter 2. Well, this was a fine pickle. How was I going to reassure Granny, and everyone else for that matter, that we were all perfectly safe and in no danger of dropping dead, without straight up contradicting Granny's beliefs? I never want to disrespect my elders. When Calvin joined us in the cafe room, after safely helping the bird fly out the window, Granny repeated her dire pronouncement. We all stared at one another without saying a word. Even Gus watched me expectantly. I reached down and absently petted his head. Now, Granny, I finally said, as gently as I could, surely it's not a hard and fast rule. Maybe sometimes a bird is a portent, and other times it's just an unfortunate bird, don't you think? Setting her jaw, she spoke in a low, sepulchral tone.
A bird flew in the window of Aunt Dottie's bedroom. 12 hours later, she was dead.
That was probably a coincidence, I insisted. Wasn't she in her 90s and suffering from diabetes?
When I was a girl, Granny continued, a bird flew in a window at my grandpappy's cabin. A week later, he was dead.
Dina and Calvin looked to me for my response. I racked my brain. There must have been plenty of times where a bird flew into a house without dooming any of its occupants. Why couldn't I think of a single example? Granny wasn't finished.
Frank's cousin's wife's brother.
Okay, I interrupted, placing my hand on Granny's. I had to put a stop to this. How about if we counteract the bad luck? Maybe we can cancel it out with some good luck. She brightened slightly.
It can't hurt, I suppose. You ought to put a horseshoe above the front door. I'll make flannel herb bags for everyone. In the meantime, we can mix salt and red clay and crumble some in our shoes.
Good, I said, clapping the table and ignoring Dina's raised eyebrow. We have a plan. Wanda left for her hair appointment, and the rest of us had a bite to eat. Then Granny went outside to dig some clay and tend the garden, while Dina and I made flower arrangements in the kitchen. Calvin planned to work outside as well. As he passed by me on his way to the back door, I reached out to touch his arm. Hey, Calvin. He met my eyes and gave me a reassuring smile.
I'll keep an eye on her.
Thanks. I dropped my hand and grinned at his retreating back. Apparently, we were on the same wavelength. The next hour passed quietly, almost too quietly. The phone didn't ring once. That's not to say we didn't have interruptions. Granny kept coming in and out. First, she came in for a container of salt. Then she returned with her salt clay mixture. She made us all remove our shoes so she could sprinkle in her protective concoction. It didn't bother me much, since I was wearing socks and sneakers. Dina, on the other hand, wore sandals today. She grimaced as Granny coated the inner soles of her sandals, but she refrained from complaining. We all wanted Granny to have peace of mind. After that, Granny still found excuses to come inside, whether to use the bathroom, get a drink, or borrow the phone to call my mom. Each time, she surveyed the kitchen for lurking dangers and cautioned us to be careful with every little sharp thing, floral scissors, shears, thorns.
After the last interruption, I called Mom myself and filled her in on the situation.
"Good grief," she said. "I'll come and pick her up and bring her to dumbbells for a while. I'll tell her I need her advice about an ant problem we have, which is true, actually."
As a former cheerleader, current aerobics instructor, and co-business owner, my mom was firmly grounded in the practical and the physical. She didn't share either Granny's superstitions or my new agey notions. Sometimes it was a source of friction. Other times, like now, it was a relief. By 3 o'clock, Dina and I were alone in the quiet kitchen once more, putting the finishing touches on all our outstanding flower orders. "What else do we need for Saturday?" she asked, referring to the grand opening of our cafe. "I think we're pretty much set," I said, "except for the centerpieces. I was thinking each table should have a small flower arrangement, maybe colorful carnations in little glass jars." "Good idea. They hold up well, don't they?" A loud tap on the back door broke into our conversation. I peered through the window and saw that it was Bart Hammerson with a bi-weekly shipment from our wholesaler, Polly's Plants. Although Felix often sourced flowers from local growers and cultivated some himself, there were some varieties that could only be imported. For as long as I could remember, it was Bart who dropped off these deliveries. Gruff, taciturn, stony-faced, Bart. I'd once asked Felix why Bart always seemed to have a chip on his shoulder. Felix had laughed.
"Does he? What do you want him to do, come in singing a song?"
Felix only cared that Bart was fast and reliable. Over the past few months, since I'd taken over Flower House, I'd been trying to get the delivery man to open up. I'd been extra friendly, making small talk and offering him water and snacks, and it seemed to be working. The last two times he'd seemed to soften a bit. Once he even cracked a joke. Today, however, he seemed to be back in his usual sour mood. "Hey there, Bart!" I held the door open wide and stepped back as he carried in a crate and set it on the floor by the cabinets. "How are you today?"
"Eh,"
he grunted. "What's the matter? Too hot for you? At least last week's heat wave is over. The rain last night cooled things off nicely." When in doubt, talk about the weather. Bart grunted again, then went out to his truck for another crate.
"Talkative guy," said Dina, once he was out of earshot.
I shrugged. Our interactions are usually pretty one-sided. I'm determined to draw him out, though. It's only a matter of time.
"Maybe he's just the strong, silent type," Dina suggested.
I said thoughtfully. "I wonder if he's married." Dina gaped at me.
"You're interested in Bart? He's got to be at least 40, don't you think?"
I peeked out the window to see Bart standing by his truck and glaring at his phone. He was stocky and nearly bald, with closely cropped fair hair and a farmer's tan. I couldn't really guess how old he was. His face was perpetually lined from all the frowning. I turned back to Dina.
"No, I'm not interested in him. At least, not in the way you mean. I'm just curious. I wonder about his story."
"His story?"
"Yeah.
Why is he always brooding? Maybe he has a sad, tragic past."
"Maybe he's just fed up with the state of the world today," said Dina.
Now my imagination was fired up.
"Maybe he's an international spy,"
I joked. Dina rolled her eyes.
"Maybe he's a criminal."
She broke off as Bart re-entered the kitchen. I stifled a giggle. He set the second crate beside the first one and picked up the clipboard he'd placed on top. Scowling, he pulled a pen from his pocket and scrawled on the paper.
"How's traffic today?" I asked.
"Terrible,"
he responded. "In Aryville?" Dina looked surprised. She'd lived in Chicago before moving back home.
"Crazy drivers," spat Bart. "They're the worst on the county roads. Either too slow or too fast. One van was so erratic it clipped me as it passed, drove me right off the road."
This was probably the biggest speech I'd ever heard Bart make. I was so stunned it took me a second to realize what he was saying.
"Wait,
You were in an accident on your way here? Are you okay? He looked over at me and nodded.
I spun out but managed to keep from going in the ditch. Truck is dented but still drives. I only wish I'd got the van's plate number.
That's terrible, said Dina. Aren't you shaken? I asked. I'd be shaken. Bart shrugged.
I was madder than anything. I tried to chase him down, but never caught up with them. They must have pulled off somewhere.
Would you like to sit down? Have a glass of water? Bart hesitated.
I'm waiting on my boss to call me back, so... Okay. Do you have any iced tea?
I'll make some. You can have a seat in our new cafe. Follow me. I led Bart up the hall to the cafe room and pulled out a ladder-back chair for him near the front window. Would you like to try one of our herbal specials? We have chamomile honey, peppermint chocolate, and rose hips and lemon. Oh, a lavender chamomile blend would be nice for soothing your nerves. He narrowed his eyebrows, clearly not impressed. We have plain black, too, I said.
Oh, I'll take plain black. Iced.
Yes, sir. I started to salute him, then felt silly and dropped my hand. Coming right up. Dina was opening the crates when I re-entered the kitchen. She'd already turned on the kettle for me. Thanks, I said, as I checked to make sure we had plenty of ice. I'm so nervous for some reason. This is like having our first customer. Or a practice customer, anyway. Do we have any pansy cookies left?
A few.
She pointed to a container on the counter. I plan to make more at home tomorrow. I prepared the tea, using the quick chill method, with less water and lots of ice. Then I sweetened it up and placed it on a serving tray with a small plate of shortbread cookies with pansy blossoms pressed on top. Bart was scowling at his phone again. He barely looked up when I set the plate and glass in front of him. At least he mumbled,
"Thanks."
Oh well, I try not to let the bad moods of others affect me too much. If I'd learned anything from all my self-help books, it was the importance of watching where you place your attention. If you don't want to feel bad, then don't dwell on things that make you feel bad, unless, of course, it motivates you to make a change. I wandered to the kitchenette on the far end of the cafe room and gave it a once-over. Seeing that we hadn't filled the napkin dispensers yet, I proceeded to do that. A few minutes later, Dina came in to let me know she'd finished unpacking the crates and was ready to head out. Thank you so much for all your help, I said. I couldn't do any of this without you.
Well, you are paying me, so it's kind of my job, she smiled. And I'm having so much fun. Who would have thought?
Calvin popped his head into the cafe, glanced at Bart, and gave me a questioning look. I beckoned him over with one finger. He joined me at the cafe bar as Dina said goodbye.
I'll call you later, she said. Say hi to your folks for me, I answered.
Calvin leaned an elbow on the counter and spoke in a low voice.
I was wondering why the delivery truck is still here. What's going on?
He's waiting to hear from his boss, I whispered.
Hey, Sierra,
called Dina, cutting me off. She stood in the arched entryway to the cafe, but was looking out the front window.
I think we're about to get a bunch of customers. Maybe I should stick around.
Really?
I scooched around the bar and ran over to the window. Sure enough, a large white passenger van had parked in front of the shop, and at least half a dozen people had emerged.
Awesome!
Calvin walked over to see for himself.
Are you sure they're coming here?
He asked. Of course they are, I said brightly. Why else would they park right in front? I grabbed his arm and looked over at Dina.
Guys, you know what this means, don't you? It means my window vision board is working.
Dina laughed. Don't get too excited yet. They might not even buy anything. I peered out the window again, wondering why it was taking them so long to come inside. They seemed to be milling about in the street and on the sidewalk. Some were stretching their arms and bouncing on their heels. One guy, in a wrinkled t-shirt and cut-off jean shorts, had lit a cigarette.
I gathered they'd been on the road for a while.
Looks like college students, Dina commented. Must be some kind of field trip.
I think you're right, I said. Some of them are holding notebooks. That older guy must be the professor or chaperone.
The older man, a lanky fellow with thinning silver hair, wire glasses, and a white goatee, slung a canteen over his shoulder and checked his watch.
So, do you want me to stay? Dina asked again.
Nah, Cal and I can handle this, if they ever come in.
Good luck, Dina said lightly, before heading toward the back.
I noticed Calvin had fallen silent. He continued to gaze out the window, only now he had a look of consternation. Before I could ask what was wrong, another car pulled up behind the school van. It was Wanda, back for Granny, who hadn't returned yet herself.
What is he doing here? Calvin muttered.
He?
Calvin nodded toward the older man.
I know him. It's Professor Lowry from UT.
At that, Bart suddenly looked up from his phone.
Did you say UT? A UT van?
He scraped back his chair and stood up to look out the window.
That's him. That's the van that ran me off the road.
Are you sure? I asked.
Calvin straightened abruptly.
You know what? I don't want to talk to him. I'll be upstairs for a while.
Startled, I followed Calvin out of the cafe room and watched as he headed to the door at the end of the hall. It opened to stairs leading up to his apartment. Gus scurried out of the office where he'd been napping and slipped around Calvin's heels. The door shut behind them, leaving me to scratch my head in confusion. Then I heard the jingle of the front door and whirled around. Bart was stalking outside. I ran to the doorway as he stomped down the sidewalk with his fists clenched. He headed straight for the professor, who appeared to be talking to Wanda. Or was she yelling at him? Why is Wanda so upset with Professor Lowry? I couldn't make out her words, but her shrill tone was unmistakable. She was really letting him have it. He didn't seem to be fazed. If anything, he seemed slightly bewildered and then mildly irritated. Mostly, he seemed to be distracted. He said something, then gave her a dismissive wave, as if swatting a fly.
Uh-oh, Wanda wasn't going to like that.
Sure enough, as soon as he turned away, she raised her handbag and swung back her arm. A roar from Bart stopped her cold. It stopped Lowry, too.
You!
Yelled Bart, so loudly I could hear him from across the front lawn.
You almost killed me! And these kids were your passengers? You might have killed them, too!
At first, Lowry seemed annoyed again, maybe even bored. He pinched his forehead before glancing down the empty street. Then, in an instant, he seemed to come to some sort of decision. It was fascinating to watch. He changed his stance, hung his head, and pressed his hands together. Just like that, he'd gone from aloof to apologetic. Bart continued to glare at him. Apparently, he had no interest in dropping the angry bear posture. Now Wanda joined in, shaking her fist once again. One of the students, the guy with the cigarette, called to the professor. He bowed to Bart and Wanda and backed away. After a quick word to the group, he strode up the brick walkway to Flower House. Quickly, I tucked my hair behind my ears and stood a little taller.
Afternoon, I chirped.
He offered a tight smile in return.
Hello. I wonder if I might use your restroom.
My restroom? It was on the tip of my tongue to say, Of course, come on in. Darn my good nature. I really couldn't help myself. But not this time. I needed to start thinking like a businesswoman.
The restroom is reserved for customers and employees.
Oh, sorry. Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Steve Lowry, professor of botany at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. I'm here with the summer field program.
That's nice.
Didn't really explain anything, but it was nice.
He gestured toward the students still milling about behind him.
Well, half the program anyway. The other van seems to have fallen behind. We're meeting them here.
Here? At Flower House? He sighed impatiently.
Is Felix here? He's expecting us.
Felix, of course. He'd done it to me again.
I left him a voice message, he continued. We stop by every July on our way to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park.
At my confused expression, he rolled his eyes.
Yes, it's out of the way, but we're here to see the orchid collection. Felix knows.
I'm sorry, Felix retired recently and he didn't tell me. Never mind, I'm Sierra, the new owner, and I'm happy to have you view our orchids and anything else you'd like. We grow our own hothouse roses, too.
Wonderful, he said shortly. Now, might I use your restroom?
Of course. Your students are welcome to come in, too, and look around. Maybe they'd like to buy a souvenir or two. He turned and beckoned to the nearest student, a petite girl with long curly blonde hair. On his signal, she rounded up the others. Without another word, he brushed past me and headed toward the hall bathroom. I stood back as the students filed in. Hi there, welcome to Flower House. There were seven of them in all, four guys and three girls, chatting among themselves. They barely acknowledged me as they fanned out, filling all four corners of the shop. I tried to direct their attention. We have a gifts table over here. You'll find postcards, greeting cards, mugs, lots of little things. I trailed off. It was no use. I could barely keep track of them all as they moved around, smelling flowers, flipping through books, picking things up and putting them down in the wrong places. Two girls in particular were starting to worry me. They'd come in with large backpacks swung carelessly over one shoulder, and they didn't seem to be aware of how much space they took up. Another guy, evidently the class clown, kept cracking jokes. His voice grew louder and louder, which seemed to give the others permission to turn up their own volume. That is, except for the blonde, curly-haired girl. She had eyes only for the guy in the denim cutoffs, who'd been smoking. He had thick, tousled dark hair and a lazy, too-cool-for-school attitude that reminded me of a 1950s biker, or a bad boy of any era, really, a rebel without a cause. She stared at him with an intensity I couldn't help noticing. He, on the other hand, was oblivious to her. He sauntered up to another boy, a preppy-looking black kid with short hair and a cute, dimpled face. The rebel lifted his chin in greeting to the preppy. In return, Mr. Preppy glanced over at Blondie before turning his back to both of them. Suddenly, the class clown called out from the cafe room.
Whoa, there's a restaurant in here. No way, said his buddy. There's food? Where? I'm starving.
You're always starving, answered one of the backpack girls.
I hurried over to the archway.
Sorry, everybody, the cafe isn't open.
Then why does he have a drink?
Said the hungry guy with a note of accusation. He was pointing at Bart, who was once again staring morosely at his phone. He must have slipped in behind the others when I wasn't looking. I wonder where Wanda got off to. Without looking away from his phone, Bart slurped his iced tea, then ate a cookie in one bite.
Can we at least order drinks?
A girl whined from behind me. We're not really set up, I began. The sound of shattering glass pulled my attention from the cafe. I ran into the front room and found one of the backpack girls staring down at a broken ceramic vase on the tile floor.
Oops, she said with a giggle. That just totally, like, fell off the table. I swear I didn't touch it.
Careful, I said, rushing forward to pick up the largest piece. As I did, I managed to slice my finger. I gasped from the sudden sting. Dang it! A tiny drop of crimson blood appeared on the side of my middle finger. Just then, an excited barking filled the room. Oh, geez.
Everybody, stay away from the glass. I need to get a broom.
And a bandage. And some backup. Gus ran up to me and jumped on my legs. "Aw, cute puppy," said one of the girls. Another voice yelled at me from the cafe.
"Hey, can we get some service in here? I want to order an iced mocha latte."
Ignoring them all, I hurried down the hallway toward the kitchen. Halfway there, I bumped into Calvin. He was carrying a dog leash.
"Hey, sorry," he said. "I was gonna take Gus out and he got away from me."
I held my injured hand in the air. "Hang on a minute," I said, dashing into the kitchen. I ripped a paper towel from the roll on the counter and quickly wadded it around my cut finger. Then I grabbed a broom and dustpan. Back in the hall, I found that Calvin had leashed Gus and was now standing by the open door of the room that housed our orchid collection. Looking past him, I saw two students standing close together, engaged in a lively whispered conversation. It was Blondie and the cute preppy boy. Only, on second glance, it appeared the boy wasn't quite as engaged as the girl. She grabbed onto his polo shirt, and he only shook his head impassively. She let go, and he turned toward the orchids, pulling a small notebook and pencil from his pocket. She wrinkled her nose at him before turning to leave. A clatter rang from the front of the shop, followed by a bellowed expletive and laughter.
"Ugh," I growled. "This is madness." "What can I do?" asked Calvin.
"Just take Gus out of here. I'll deal with these hooligans." I hurried to the front and almost tripped when a backpack girl stepped in front of me without looking.
"Sorry,"
she said, twirling a single-stem pink rose. "It's okay." I waved my paper towel-wrapped hand toward the checkout counter. "Wait for me by the cash register and I'll ring you up for the flower in just a minute."
"Is there a vending machine?"
came another voice from the cafe. For a split second, I stood rooted to the floor. I couldn't decide which direction to go. I needed to clean up the broken glass.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.